Jesus veio ao mundo. By the mercies of God. Shout one powerful hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
I'm not convinced. So maybe you think you pay for the air you are breathing. Maybe you think you pay for the legs you use in walking. But if you know that it is not by your doing, someone somewhere, someone decided that you wake up this morning, not your alarm clock. Someone decided that you'll be alive today, not you. If you recognize the person of the Lord God Jehovah Yahweh, send them one powerful hallelujah just to say thank you.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah. Let's sit down in the presence of the Creator. I give glory to God for a wonderful Sunday like this. Very nice weather. And I'm grateful to our daddy. Thank you very much, sir, for this opportunity. I'm humbled in your presence. And the list of the persons that should stand in this place. But it's a grace. I'll give glory to God for your life, sir. And the Spirit of God will not depart from you. The Holy Spirit will continue to re-energize you for the purpose for which He has established you in this country.
Amen.
And souls shall be returned to God through you in the name of Jesus. For He said, light to call me, Lord, son. Son, son of Onyoluwa. You know what you sharing. The Lord God has established you. He will make you great and make you a pillar in His house in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Without wasting time, I'll try as much as possible. Let me not say rush over what I have, because I want us to pray. I want to lay emphasis on the prayer time than the word. But I will implore you, however boring it might sound to you, please borrow me your focus for the next 20 minutes. Why? I said in my prayer, someone here has a date with destiny. But the moment the whole world was created, somebody here has been determined, deemed, finalized, confirmed to listen to this. I don't know who that person is. It might be me. It might be you. So please, endure my boringness for the next 20 minutes. You never can tell. That message might be for you. So this morning we'll be talking together on the topic atonement, the real story behind salvation. Atonement, the real story behind salvation. Now, When we say salvation, the first thing that comes to our mind is what? Huh? Somebody say Jesus Christ, isn't it?
Yes.
So you bala. Ah. Money bala. Jesus Christ. Talora wapada. Jesus Christ. Talora Jesus Christ. But for salvation to take place, there was needed for something. There's a need. Something happened to the person of Jesus Christ. He undertook a process, a journey. And that process is the atonement. Because man made a grave mistake in Eden. And for the nature of man, man naturally is submissive. A company knows that seek to worship, to obey, to say yes sir to somebody. No matter how independent you think you are, in your DNA, God made it, and you bow down to something. You may not know. You are obeying something. You are obeying someone. Sadly, these days, if I tell you what you obey, you will not believe. Should I tell you? We obey our phones. You want to sleep and he drinks. Don't worry. Mm-hmm. In the presence of God. So naturally, we are made to obey. It's in us. We really, whatever we do, there's this instinct in us that we want to say yes to something. So because of that, we are addicted to servitude. We are addicted to saying, I agree, I worship. And that has been our modus operandi since Eden. We have always been like that. But God made us to be his companion. He sought for companionship with man. And why he said, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power. For thou hast created all things for what? His pleasure. So he sought for companionship, and that is why the Bible says, in the cool of the evening, God will walk in Eden. And we chat. It's a WhatsApp chat. Face to face chat. How I wish I was alive then. Adam was very lucky to see God in the evening. As he said, that hour of the Friday evening, one happy hour for God. And she's my sorrow to Father. So that companionship was very, very important to God. But man took a wrong turn. And that was sin. Which brings me to the first part of this message. What is sin? Because when you talk about atonement, you're talking about paying a price for the sin committed. That's basically what it means. You pay a price. You pay for somebody. Okay? If I had my chance, I would have just done a little bit of drama. I'm a drama person, sorry, don't mind me. Just imagine a little child catching a bird and putting it in a cage. And he's tormenting that bird, playing with it, and thinking. But someone comes and says, why are you disturbing that bird? He says, it's my bird. I'm playing with it. But that bird is crying. You know, I'm playing with it. He's enjoying it. He's not enjoying it. Okay, you know what? How much do you want for this bird? Let me go and look at you. Give me $5. Is that all? Okay, give me $10. Is that all? Okay, $20. Is that all? $200. Is that all? Okay, $1,000. Is that all? Yes. Take it. And the man collected the bread and opened the cage and tell the bread, you can go. And the man looked at the man and said, why did you pay? I said, the bread is mine. I've paid for it. Isn't it? I can do whatever I like with my bread. So the price that was paid for that bread is the atonement. But for that bird, which is you, to be in that cage, something happened. What was that thing? Sin. Now, in the definition of sin, in the course of my research, preparing for this message, I discovered that what we call sin in the Greek world is called hamata. And that is, in the old Grecian age, you know, they started the Olympics. Part of the games they play is archery, bow and arrow. And when they are doing their own archery, at the center of the target, they will keep a gold coin there. So whosoever hits that target earns that gold coin. So the process of you missing that mark is called sin. They will say that person committed a sin. Inadvertently, using the word down to us today, when you commit sin, you have missed the target. There is a target that is made for you, for your life, by God. So every time you commit sin, you miss the target. Every time you commit sin, you miss the target. Now, how did we find ourselves here? Of course, we know the story in Eden. The devil came, in quote, as serpent, made a suggestion to Eve. Eve ate the apple, gave to Adam. And so on and so forth. But that is just the beginning of the story. Do not be deceived. God was not happy that happened. Why? Remember I said at the beginning that he created us for his pleasure. There is a purpose for which he has created us. Please, hear this and hear this well. God cannot make mistakes. It is not in the future. Is too organized to make a mistake. The only factor that always changes at every point in time since the inception of time is man. But I said, well, my hands are not too short. Neither are my ears there to hear you. But what? Your sins. God never moves. Man always do the moving. And hear this. That movement comes involuntarily. You don't know. The moment you commit sin, something in you just moves you away from God. If before you commit that sin, you normally have your prayer time like 1 hour. Naturally, all of you are either doing it, but you will have a dry. I can relate to me. 1 hour, an hour, 45 minutes. If you don't quickly run back to the master, the next time you kneel down, I just whisper to you, show me quick. 45 minutes, I've been quietly, 30 minutes. Before you know it, 30 minutes here, I've been 3 years away from God. Before you know it, I've been 10 years away from God. Before you know it, I've been in the room. I've been in the room. Yes, I'm alone. All they took was to say, I'm sorry. So sin is a very crucial thing in the relationship between man and God. Listen, it is high time for Christians to stop trivializing sin. God does not trivialize sin. His nature, his character, his holiness. We sometimes misconstrue it. We sometimes confuse it. No. Holiness is God's nature. And that's why he said he cannot behold sin. Not because he deformed. No. It is just not in his nature to accommodate sin. Maybe this will explain it better. Is there anybody in the house with an allergy? Anybody with an allergy? Nobody. Have you ever seen anybody with an allergy before? You see, whatever they are allergic to, how do they react to it? That's how God reacts to sin. I don't take peanuts. If you're eating peanuts, it's as bad. If you're buying jail, my leg burning. I need to move away because perceiving it alone is trouble for me.
So if you see someone with serious edema, see Alex, you're going to move everything. See, that's how God feels when you bring sin close to him. Because it is not his nature to come in contact with sin. So, what will he do? Decided, okay, man made a mistake in Eden. What do we do? Oh yeah, you want daddy? Send them out. Instead of man coming back, remember my analogy of you praying in the morning, only 45 minutes. Instead of man coming back immediately, man went ahead and committed another sin, which worsened the situation for that. The shedding of blood. The moment Cain killed Abel, we sealed our fate. Probably there would have been a chance for redemption if our sin had stopped at disobedience. But the Bible recorded that the blood of Abel cried to God. Now, the subject of blood is for another day, because God is very serious about the issue of blood. If you want to know, go and read the book, go and read Genesis. After the flood, God specifically told Noah, look, guys, I don't want you eating raw meat because of the blood. You must cook it so that the blood will get out. There's a covenant, there's something peculiar about blood. I'll find out today in the course of this message. So, the moment blood was shed, we sealed our fate, and then we began a journey that has spanned over more than 3,000 years. We began that journey. Now, because man had moved from not disobeying to now committing murder, shedding of blood, evil became a part of us. Evil packed his bags and baggages and lived with man. And the stench of evil rose to God to the point that he could not contain it anymore. And he said, the first statement of regret, so I am sad that I created man. Something that was created for his pleasure. God had to utter that he regretted making man. So he made the first attempt at reconciliation. Okay, maybe if I wipe out everything that created, man inclusive, and then retain one person that I know that I can vouch for, maybe we can start this journey all over again. So he sought out Noah and said, the Bible recorded Noah as a man who is diligent, serving God, you know. And God gave him a vision, gave him a mission that, look, build the ark. In XYZ number of days, I will flood the earth with water and I will wipe out everything and I will start all over again. Now, in as much as I don't blame Noah, I need to say this to you this morning. When God gives you a vision, be careful who you take along. If you go through the Bible very well, everybody who receives a vision from God and decides to take extra luggage always leave to regret it. It is not your fault. Companionship is part of human being. But when God gives you a vision, he gives you with a mission and he expects you to carry it to perfection. And he gives you the unction to function to that perfection. But if you decide to carry extra luggage, that extra luggage can never share your vision because he or she was not there when God gave it to you. Bomidada. Your vision is a one-on-one thing with God. Whatever is happening to you, until God tells you, go ahead and do this with your vision, you have no right to use man's knowledge to carry out your vision. Not until God told Moses, appoint elders to help you out with this work. He went to the letter with everything God told him, except for that point where he was told to touch the rock and then he struck the rock. So, I just quickly want to share that with you. If God gives you a vision, Be careful who you carry along. Now, Noah received the vision, built the ark. He got the specs, did everything. What was Noah's undoing? His family. Because after God did the cleansing, his own part of the deal, what happened? Man, as they say in the medical clinic, man went into remission. Starting with Noah himself. He did incest. And we went back to the beginning again. And evil returned. And then the cycle begins all over again. But then, at that point, man recognized that there is a need for us to withdraw sin from our life. There's a need to remove sin. There's a need for cleansing, constant cleansing. So, man devised a plan. And in the course of my research, I came about a name that called sin eaters. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When I mention the word salvation and I ask you, what comes to mind, I say Jesus Christ. Listen to me. In various cultures of the world, the idea of removing sin from people had existed long before now. Even in our own Yoruba tradition, there's a concept of Aruba that happens in Asia every year. A young virgin be picked by a lorry will now walk through the entire town. Everybody, I'm a sorcery. And the girl will walk through the town and take it to a location that nobody knows. Now, that is in Yoruba culture. In the Jewish culture, the same thing existed, only in a different form. They call it Yom Kippur. A goat is itemized by the priest. It's during the period of Passover. And the priest will lay hands on that goat and take all the sin of the all Israelites, put it on that goat and send it away to the desert. No question alone. That is aside of the regular, you know, recharge card of goats, ram that you take to the priest. Atima, you know, who service a shell, what is sacrifice, what is can be. As a coyote, I was being missing. While I was in for the missing. As a woman, I got woman who had done. What about room? I look like way, maybe she was in the low low. But it's there at the end of my mouth. And you should get your Ferrari chat condition. And then you give it to the show, you don't take it. What's in law? What's in the show? I said, my defense. That's what I do. That's what I'm going to show. Chat condition. So apart from that, there's a particular time in the year that the priest would place his hand on a goat and send that goat forth. That existed in the Jewish tradition. Then in the old English tradition, there existed some men that are regarded as religious men. Now, it was founded, or people saw it in the Christian religion, but it was not limited to the Christian religion. They are really called sin eaters. And what they do is, when a man dies, they call the sin eater. And then they will give that man, they will bring food. And usually the food is rubbish food, beer bowl. Sometimes it will be bread and milk. And the man will stand over the corpse, say some things, and eat that food. And thereby taking that person's sin. And the man leaves. So they practiced that for a long time until the Catholic took over Christianity. And the issue of confession came into it. So when the Catholics assumed the role of the confessor thing, and when one absorbed the shame, so they blackmail the sin eaters and tell everybody, if you visit or you patronize sin eaters, you are committing idolatry. So their practice died out. But thank God for Jesus Christ. Thank God for Jesus Christ. Because what was wrong in what the sin eaters was doing, what is wrong in the concept of Aruba, or what is wrong in the Yom Kippur, is that all what they were doing was nothing but bandage. Never solve the problem. Problem always reoccur. Let us see the Bible. So it is very, very, very important for us to understand that man may not know, but because he is built to be obedient to something, and he feels it when the person you are being obeyed, you are paying obeisance to, is not feeling you, and you obey more. When your son or your child, what is in control that, and what you machine, when you don't want to be what you machine, tell it. Withdraw. It is natural. So all these things we devise it, but solve it. It was not giving us what we need. So with the concept of the sin eaters and all the rituals and everything that we've been doing, it was not solving it. Let's look at the book of Hebrews chapter 8 verse 7.
For eat. That first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second.
Okay.
But finding fault with them,
mm-hmm.
he said, Behold, mm-hmm. the days come, said the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel.
Thank you. Let's open to the second lesson, and that is where we'll look at it, and I said, Hebrews 9 from 11.
But Christ being come,
okay,
and high priest of good things,
mm-hmm.
to come,
mm-hmm.
by a greater and more perfect tabernacle,
yeah.
not made with hands,
yeah.
that is to say, not of building, neither by the blood of goats or calves.
Elohim 9, verse 16.
For where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator.
All right, ma'am. Thank you. Now, let me quickly constrict the remaining part of the message. The sin eaters and everything we've been doing was faulted. Hence, the Hebrews 8, 7. There's a fault in it because it was not working. And there's a need for an ultimate price to be paid. And what God did was, another person please open to the book of Hebrews 9, no, 2 Corinthians 5, 21. Okay, 2 Corinthians 5:21. So it was faulted. It was practically not working because we were doing the same thing all over again.
He had made him to be seen.
Who?
For us.
Yes.
Who knew no sin?
Thank you.
Made righteousness.
So what God did was to look for the ultimate sacrifice. One, just one sacrifice. Now, before now, there existed a covenant between God and Abraham. The Abrahamic covenant. God said, "You rule more, they might feel anything." He said, "Look to the stars. As there are many numbers of stars, so shall your descendants be." He said, "Look to the ground. As the grains on the stars, so shall your descendants be." After that covenant with Abraham, which he fulfilled by bringing them to the land of Canaan after Egypt, on the way to Canaan, he changed the covenant in the Mosaic covenant as bringing back the Ten Commandments. Now, the Ten Commandments was limited to the children of Israelites. They lived by those covenants, and he gave them some rules: how they should dress, what they should do, what they should eat, who they should marry, how they should go about their marriage. Different. He planned their society for them, because for 400, you can imagine 400 years, you are living someone else's life. Imagine the number of generations that are believing that they are Egyptians. They only heard of God of Abraham in stories. So God created the Israelites' mode of life on the way to Canaan. Now, with the Ten Commandments, a new covenant began. And that's why I said in the book of Deuteronomy 28, verse 1. What's up, Kenny? Yosishe. Yo, back for a while, go on, all right. Láti ṣe kíni gbogbo òfin tí mo pa láṣẹ fún ọ. So he itemized those things that will happen to you if you keep those covenants. But then you agree with me that the world has moved from between God and Abraham to God and the world. Because the children of Israelites, they are no longer just Israelites anymore. They've interacted with the world. So anywhere in the world today, you will find an Israelite. So if God must keep his covenant with Abraham and make sure that his children will reign with him at last, then he must rewrite that covenant. He needs to change the terms of reference. The articles in that covenant need to change. So, the covenant with Jesus Christ came. The ultimate price. Now, in the book of Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22. I want to make reference to that blood I said at the beginning.
And almost all things are by the law, purged with blood.
Thank you.
And without shedding of blood is no remission.
Thank you very much. Remember, I said at the beginning that the moment Cain killed Abel, it sealed our fate. So for us to get out of that problem, there is need for another shedding of blood. A blood that is as pure as Abel. Although, by my standard, I will not call Abel pure. Why? It's a product of sin. So God had to step up. Step up from anything around here and decide to move to a higher level. And then we have a decree. I believe in what? And who? Who is he? Kilo Jesse. One. Two. Efiokule. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, not by man. He withdrew that aspect out of it. So at the conception of Jesus Christ, God changed. He changed the equation. What changed your mind should know? Because every covenant was shaped, the devil finds a way into it and so God went back to the root. He said, okay, from the conception, I will change the terms of reference. Holy Spirit, Father, Jesus Christ. Of course, they are one. Trinity. Now, to not make matters worse for the devil, no way I could be a virgin. Until one. Very pure, fertile land. We are in peace. Now, it has now given us a different format. It now gave the devil a different playing field. Move the game from where he is very comfortable.